I'm Rick McLennan. I'm the president of Garrett College, and it's my honor and pleasure, privilege to welcome you all here tonight. It's so wonderful, especially with the weather that we got this afternoon or evening, to see this kind of a turnout. This is the second in this year's Joan Crawford Lecture Series. It's a series we began about 4 years ago, and I couldn't be more pleased to greet and welcome tonight's honored guest, Mr. Rubin Sztajer. Professor Lurz is going to introduce him in just a moment, but I just wanted to say welcome, and we really appreciate all of you being here tonight and the support that you give Garrett College. I hope you and I know you'll enjoy tonight's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. I need to lower that. Good evening, and as Dr. McLennan said, welcome to the Joan Crawford Lecture Series. Tonight we have a very special guest with us, Mr. Rubin Sztajer. He wants us to call him Rubin. Rubin was born in Klobuk, Poland in 1926, and even in the 1920s there was some anti-Semitic activity in his hometown. It was to get much, much worse for him and other Jews when Germany invaded Poland on the 1st of September 1939. Jews were first sent to the ghettos to live under very harsh conditions. Later, they were sent to concentration camps. Rubin was sent to several camps, enduring hard labor and unimaginable treatment. At liberation in 1945, he was in Bergen-Belsen, where his sister Gussie found him unconscious and near death's door. She did everything she could to save him, and it took 3 years for him to regain his health. Rubin found a new home in Baltimore, Maryland, in 1949. He found a job, he got married, he raised three children, and he has spent years speaking about his experiences and showing others what happens when hatred is allowed to take root. It is an honor to give you Rubin Sztajer.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me check this out first. Can you hear me in the back? Okay, good. The best way for evil to flourish is for good people to say nothing. During the 1930s and 1940s, the world stood idly by and allowed Hitler to flourish. That's why we had a Holocaust. The Holocaust is something that cannot, should not, and must not be compared. Nothing like this ever happened. And our being here today, it makes sure that these things don't happen again. We know that 6 million Jews were slaughtered, not just died. They were brutally murdered in pain. But what are 6 million? If we were to take every man, woman, and child in the state of Maryland, we would not come up with 6 million. Give you another example. We just observed 9/11, 14 years, where 3,000 people died in one day. During the Holocaust, for 5.5 years, it averaged 3,000 people every single day. Men, women, and children. But that's people. When the war broke out, I was 13 years old. My parents said, there's a war going on, we must leave our homes. We took a few of the things that we could carry and we left our homes. We marched all day. It was a Friday. And in Jewish religion, Friday at sunset, the Sabbath begins. We're not supposed to do anything. We stopped in a field, we had a little food with us, we said our prayers, and we slept out all night. The next morning, the Germans caught up to us. They told us we're liberated, We can turn around, we can go home. We turned around and marched towards our home. Before we reached our town, everyone was stopped, Jews and Christians alike. They immediately separated the Jews from the Christians. While the Christians were allowed to go home, we were detained till Sunday early afternoon. Then we too were told we can go home. Outside of the village, the road divided. Those that went to the right, which my family were among them, came home safely. Those that went to the left, 272 men, women, and children were shot to death. Their crime they committed, they were born of the Jewish faith. Monday morning, the Holocaust really began. We had one synagogue in town. We were told to come to the synagogue. They made us carry out the prayer books and the scrolls, which the Old Testament is written in them. They poured gasoline and they burned them. I assume they did it to scare us, to frighten us, to dehumanize us. And they pretty well succeeded. We were also told that from now on we're to come to the town square and read the new law specifically designed for Jews. Not what we can do, but what we cannot do. For example, if I walked on a sidewalk and a German approached me, I had to go in the gutter. I wasn't worried walking on the same dirt as they did, and so many other things. I do not have specific dates, but I do remember the seasons and the events. In the spring of 1940, we were told to leave our home and move into an area called the ghetto. I'm sure you all heard the word ghetto being used here. But in this country where you have a certain ethnic group, color, religion, nationality, or whatever, living in one area, it's called a ghetto. But you can come and you can go, you can stay there, you can leave, you're free to do whatever you want. Not the ghetto that I'm going to describe to you. I come from a family of eight. We were given one room, probably no bigger than the children your children have at home. How do eight people live in one room? Because we didn't have any mode of transportation, we took a few of the things that we could carry. Like you see on the first poster on my left. We took a little bedding, a little clothes, the bare necessities, pots and pans, the little food we had, and we moved into that one-room apartment. In that room, we had one bed. My mother and my younger sister slept in it. The rest of us had a bed down over a stable. Sometimes they're not as hot and humid as they are here. It's bearable. But in the winter time, it gets very, very cold, usually below zero. We wore our clothes 24 hours a day just to keep warm. But that was not a big problem where we're going to sleep. I have done it, and I think most of you here could do the same. When you're tired enough to get down this floor, stretch out your arms, put your head on, and fall asleep. There were many more bigger problems than that. In the slum area, as it is even here, there are no jobs, there are no factories, there are no businesses, there's no income. We had to find a way how to get a little food, how to get a little money so we can cash in for the coupons that they allowed us. At 14, I had to be a man. I had to grow up very quickly. What we did, we smuggled out at night, crawled in our arms and legs and our bellies in the field where the farmers planted something, dug up with our hands, and brought that home. On the way, I was hoping I'd pass a couple fruit trees and throw up a rock or a branch, anything I could get my hands on, and knock down one or two fruits and bring that home. Once we brought it home, my mother had to ration it. Because in this fall, what about in the fall, winter, and spring, where nothing was growing, we had to find a way how to get something, a little money. We knew that most Poles were very anti-Semitic. They did not like Jews. I learned that practically the day I was born. When I went to school, I had to sit in the back because I was Jewish. We did not have in the school indoor plumbing, we had outhouses. Once I got in the classroom, no matter what nature called, no matter what, how I felt, I would not leave to go use those outhouses. Kids used to sit outside in the yards, and our playgrounds were not paved like they are here. They were made out of sand and stones. They used to sit there with handfuls of sand and stones and throw in our faces. Every Jewish home had to have shutters, because if we didn't, at night they used to throw a rock through it. And there were so many other things that went on. But we had to take chances. What we did in the spring, summer, and fall, fall, winter, and spring, we smuggled out of the ghetto into the Christian area, took chances, tremendous chances, knocked on doors, hoping that they would open up, and had to try to make a quick transaction, try to sell anything we had of value, and make a quick transaction, not to give them a chance to call the authorities. Any wrong move would cost us our lives, and then run away. Even there was a problem, because the snow starts coming down around November, doesn't leave until sometimes in March. Our roads or sidewalks were not paved. They were covered with snow, and if we all know that we walk in snow, you leave footprints, and that would be suicidal. In 1942, the purpose of the ghetto was to have all Jews concentrated in one small area. When they were ready to take us away, they had us all in one corner. They did not have to go around and look for us. In this April of 1942 was a date I will never forget. We heard there was going to be a roundup, able-bodied men and women. I was 16 years old, small for my age. My parents felt when they come, they're not going to take me, I'm a child. Little did they know then what was about to happen. So I stayed at home. My father, older brother, and older sister went to hiding. I still don't know where they hid, but it really doesn't matter. The middle of the night, we heard a truck pulling up. We knew they had come to take some of us. My mother immediately went to the door, and no sooner did she get in, there was a knock on the door. She knew if she doesn't open it up right away, they're going to break it, and we had no way of replacing it. Now, as soon as they knocked on the door, she opened it up, and they came in like a tank. They knocked her down, and yelled out the names of my father and older brother, where are they? My mother said, I don't know. I'm pretty sure she did not. They kept on screaming, yelling, the same question, and they got the same answer. They looked at me and told me to stand up. I stood up and they came over and grabbed me by my arm. My mother, as any of your mothers, grabbed me by the, took me around. But she and I were no match. They pulled me out from my mother's arms and took me away from me never to see my parents. My younger brother and two younger sisters. I don't know what the Germans looked like. I did not look at them, but I will never forget the faces, the tears, the pain they must have felt. My mother and my three younger siblings that stayed at home. I was taken away and taken to a camp. When we all got there, they took several things from us. We had to get undressed, leave all our clothes behind. There had teams of men going through it to see whether anything of value was in there. And they gave each one of us, or they even took my name. They gave me a number. that lasted 3 years and 3 days, 25, 685. And they gave each one of us a new outfit consisting of a pair of pants and a jacket, set underwear top and bottom sewn together, pair of shoes without socks, a blanket to serve as a sheet and a cover, and a burlap bag to fill up with straw that became my mattress. No change of clothes. And then we were assigned into a barrack. It had bunk beds. It had one window on one end, a door on the other end. It had two long tables with benches on each side, and two buckets for human waste. Night there was curfew, after dark there was curfew, we were not allowed to go out. I filled up the straw and I put it up on my bunk and I climbed up and I put my face into it. And I lied there all night crying. I'm 16 years old, I've never been away from home. I never knew what it's like being away from my parents. What is going to happen to me, and all kind of things that went through my mind that each one of us here would think of. But the next morning, the Germans made sure I didn't have time to cry. I didn't even have time to think. It became a routine. They woke us up at 6 o'clock. 6:30, they gave us a cup of substitute coffee. No bread, no cereal, no nothing. At seven o'clock, we had to be ready, lined up in the rows of five to be counted, and we marched to work for a whole hour. First day we got there, they gave each one of us a shovel. Told us if we lose the shovel, we'd have to dig dirt with our hands. So that became part of me. Then we started working. We worked from 8 till 12, nonstop, no matter what the weather was. Rain or shine, snow or sleet. There were no snow days. It was work days every day. We worked from 8 to 12, and then from 12 to 12:30, we had so-called rest period. If the weather was nice and it wasn't cold, I would just lie down in the dirt, stretch out my arms, put my head on it, just lie there sometimes, take a quick nap, or just lie there and rest. Then work from 12:30 to 6 again and stop. 6:30 we were counted and marched back to camp for a whole hour. We got back there at 7 o'clock and we had one barrack housed two items. One side was boards cut out with holes that we used for toilets. The other side, showers, about a dozen showers. We were around 1,200 men, and we had a half an hour time to use both facilities. If you take and break that down, 1,200 divided into 30 minutes, it's 1.5 seconds time to use each facility. The first three men that had a chance to get in had a little hot water. The rest of us cold water. The summertime, it was very refreshing to get any kind of water just to cool off. What about in the wintertime or even in the spring or fall? Even if I had the chance to go in and get a little hot water, I would not do it. Because the things that we all take so much for granted, myself included today, we did not have. We did not have a towel to dry ourselves off. We did not have any toilet paper, tissues, toothpaste, all the things that we find in our bathrooms. What that meant, we walked around for weeks and months without putting a drop of water in our bodies. And if you don't bathe, lice form, and they're very infectious, usually typhus. It helped them kill us sooner, quicker. At 7:30, they gave us our rest for the day. The whole time that I was in the camps, I never saw a piece of meat, a fruit, a vegetable, butter, milk, all the things that we eat. They gave us a cup of soup made out of rutabagas that they would feed the cattle, and a small portion of bread that had to last 24 hours. I truly feel if there is a miracle, at least in my mind, that has to be the greatest miracle for anyone like myself to survive on so little food, work so hard under those unsanitary conditions. In 43, we were transferred from one camp to the other. The kind of work we did, I forgot to mention, was we moved mountains into valleys. They would have plenty of work, we would have had plenty of work in this area here. So they could build ammunition factories. We were not allowed to build ammunition factories, I assume because of sabotage or whatever they had in mind. In the first camp we had the Wehrmacht, the military, they were middle-aged men. They weren't so bad, by not so bad. They left us alone most of the time. But in the next camp, we ran into a different kind of breed of guards. If you've ever been to the National Archives Museum on the fourth floor, you see them, the Hitler's elite, the SS. I still can't figure out how a man can leave a family home, a wife and children, and go to work, and doing what they did, being so brutal, so mean, so vicious, and be able to live with themselves. The punishments are also much more severe. The two most often punishments that they used, we had to take a chair, crouch down on our toes, don't put your heels down, and you guys may want to try it, and lift it, pick it up, two hands, by the front legs, because the rear legs has the back, more weight, they pull you down. If by accident I put my heels down, they would turn over the center and start all over again. The other one was specially designed desk-like. It would lock our feet in our necks and use the whip. Sometimes 25, sometimes 50 lashes, depending on what they considered the crime. Sometimes they allowed us to keep our pants up. Other times we had to pull them down. When we had to pull our pants down, when they finished, all we could do is find a rag. What they did is they cut through the flesh, wipe off our blood, clean ourselves off without water the best we could, but make sure that we go to work the next day. Anyone that could not go to work would be sent away, never to be seen or heard from again. The camp before last was a camp that we heard that there was going to be the death marches. I don't know whether you ever read about it or heard about it. Those were the marches we marched in the winter. But we had to learn how to help us survive with what we did not have. We didn't have a Band-Aid, we didn't have an aspirin, we didn't have anything. But we had to learn other things. Most of the things I'm not going to talk about, they're either too personal or too graphic. One of the things I learned, that if you take paper, put it between your clothes, it keeps the wind out. Therefore, keep your body temperature in. I took a cement paper bag and I put it between my clothes. And they gave each one of us a small loaf of bread. But they also gave us a pair of wooden shoes. Maybe some of you ladies wore wooden sole shoes. If you walk in snow, the snow sticks to the wood. If you don't kick it off, you can twist an ankle or break a leg. We marched on roads covered with snow and fields. The weak ones, when they kicked off, some of them fell down, they couldn't get up fast enough, they would shoot him. And a truck would follow us and pick up bodies like a pickup trash on a highway. We marched all day, and once it got dark, they finally told us to stop and rest. But we're out in the open. The field is covered with snow, and over our head, we have the skies. I had a decision to make, sit down or be killed, something happens. I chose to sit down and take my chances. How I survived, I don't know, being out in the open all night. We marched for 3 days. After 3 days, they finally marched us over to the railroad track. Again, if you've been to the museum in Washington, you've seen the railroad car, a box car. If there is a hell, any one of us that was in those box cars, we've been there, we've done it. They opened, a train pulled up and they opened up the gates and they pushed in about 100 or so, as many as they could, like sardines. They gave each one of us a loaf of bread and that famous bucket to use for human waste, and they closed the gates. Had it been the summertime, we would have suffocated from lack of air. Fortunately, it was fall, winter, whatever it was. There wasn't any room to sit down. But men started dying right from the beginning. We put them in the center of the car, like a pyramid. And a little room became available. But when I looked down at that floor and saw what it looked at, I could not get myself, no matter how tired I was. The bucket overran, and it spread all over the floor. And you have to use your imagination. After a while, again, you do what you have to. I used dead bodies to put my head on it. I couldn't get my face down. The best way, and I'm not going to describe it any further, it's very, very graphic. The best way I can describe it, after 3 days and three nights in that car, they finally opened up to let us out. 10 of us walked out alive. The rest of them were all dead. I don't know whatever happened to them. I was then taken to a camp called Bergen-Belsen. Bergen-Belsen did not have any crematorium or gas chambers. They did not need it. All they had to do is put us there and nature would take care of us. I was hoping when I get there, at least there's going to be a little straw. I can lie down and rest. Instead, they put us in an empty shell. The floors were wet because there were holes in the roof. I guess when the sun melted, some of the snow dripped down. We sat down between each other's legs to keep the wind out. And like a domino effect, we fell back and fell asleep. The next morning, it became a routine for the remainder of my incarceration. They woke us up between 4 and 4:30 and made us go outside, bring out all the dead bodies, pile them up in fives, and stay there and wait until about 2:30 to be counted. They turned on the water between 10 and 10:30, but we were not allowed to get out of line. That meant that we did not have any kind of, not even a drop of water. I literally prayed for snow or rain. If it would rain, I would just put the palms of my hands out and try to catch a few drops of rain, anything to get some fluid in my body. If it snowed, I would just take it off my clothes or even get down on the ground to pick up some little snow. Sometimes it was dirt in it and spit it out. After we were counted, they gave us our ration for the day. I mentioned before, we got a piece of bread and some soup. They took the bread away, I assume maybe to speed up the dying. All they gave us is a little bit of soup. After we finished, we had a job to do. Let me go back a little bit, I forgot to mention. On the second poster, you see that how a ghetto looked like. We spent most of our time outside. There wasn't any room inside. On the next poster, you see that car, how they pushed in our people. It just left me for a moment. They just gave us that cup of soup to eat. That had to last the whole 24 hours. After we ate, we had a job to do. The camp was literally littered with dead bodies. We walked around people. If you can see on the next poster, people just dropped dead. Our job was to remove him. We tied them on with their arms and legs with belts. There were tens of thousands of belts. And dragged them in mud and snow and threw them into huge graves. Thousands of them in there in the next poster that you can see over there. We would not stop until everyone was removed. After we finished our job, we just stood outside because the stench inside was unbearable. They brought in transport every single day. One day a group of women were coming in. I didn't know what I was doing, I guess staring at the sky. And I heard someone yelling my name, Rubin. I turned around and I saw a familiar face I had not seen for 3 years. It was my older sister. I could not go out to her, she could not come into me. We were like fenced in. She had to keep on moving. Now I knew that she was there, I did not know where she was. Is she dead or is she alive? These graves were near the women's section. Every time I was there and I saw a woman lying face down, dead, I would turn her over hoping that I won't recognize her. Finally, the day the so-called liberation came. I say so-called liberation, it's now been about 67 years and I'm still here. What about all of those that finally made it, finally liberated, saw a little daylight, are almost liberated, and are in those graves? Among those that died just before liberation is a young lady, I'm sure that most of you youngsters read her book. Her name is Anne Frank. I keep on wondering what would have Anne Frank accomplished, what would she have achieved had she been around, had she been alive today? What about all the others that would have contributed so much to humanity and not with us? What if Dr. Sabin would not have escaped Nazi Germany? How many of us here would have polio today? What if the founder of Intel would not have been saved by a Christian family, would have been an Intel? How about my family that you see here? My parents, my three younger siblings, what would they have contributed? And why? Why did the world stand idly by, quiet, as if nothing happened? And unfortunately, it's happening today. When I was liberated, I was as close to dying as anyone could be. When the English came in, I could not walk anymore. My right leg was about twice the size. I still don't know what it was. I was weak. But I saw some men going to a warehouse, and I figured there must be something that I might want. I couldn't walk, I dragged myself over with the last bit of energy in my body. When I got there, I saw bread. I cannot tell you what that bread looked like to me. The biggest lottery couldn't make me that happy. I pulled over two small loaves of bread and I put them in my coat. Between the lining and outer fabric, lice and all. A man saw me having them, he took them away from me and I wasn't strong enough to fight him. And then I went into a coma. For quite a few days, I don't know how many, I was dead. the way people found each other, they went through the living, the dead, to see whether they recognized somebody, and all of our loved one, a friend, anyone. A girl from my town saw me, and she notified my sister. My sister does not talk about it. She cannot, and I can understand. But she gives me bits and pieces here and there once in a while. She came down to Baltimore, and I was going to speak to a class. I said to her, Garcia, I'm going to speak. Why don't you come with me and listen to me? She says, you know, I don't talk about it. I said, I do. I'm not asking you. All I want you to do is come and listen. Maybe you can add, subtract, or something. And she agreed. When I got there, after I finished, the first question was, what was it like after liberation? I turned to her and I said, you know, I don't know what happened. I was out. Why don't you tell? And she agreed. When she was brought to me, she found me naked. I assume the reason why I had done it, if I saw a man dead, and his clothes were cleaner than mine, I would just take it off him and put it on me where he was going, it didn't matter. Somebody must have thought I was dead. If she hadn't found me, and he took my clothes, if she hadn't found me, they probably would have tied on the belts and threw me into those graves thinking I was dead. She took off her clothes, her underwear, and put it on me. She gave me back a little life. I truly feel she saved my life. I was born, my mother gave birth to me, and she gave life back to me at age 19. She took a rag and dipped it in water and put it in my face, tried to make me a little comfortable. She did something, everything that she could and then some, to save my life. I was a vegetable, I could not move, I could not talk, I could not do anything. And I was still in the death camp for about 4 weeks. Holocaust teaches us an awful lot. If I look at you youngsters, I keep on thinking, what is it like being your age? What's it like being a teenager? What's it like being young? I don't know, I didn't have it. And I keep on thinking, what did I miss? You are so lucky and so fortunate that you were born in this country and you have what you have. That goes for your for the adults too, but especially for the young people. Your future looks so bright, you have no idea. You think everything is coming to you, you think that you're entitled to everything. Think what you have. You're going to school, you get an education, you have parents. I do not. I don't even have a grave to go to, so I can go there and stay there and tell him how much I miss him, how I love him. The same thing for those three younger siblings. You have siblings home. You have a home. You have so much to look forward to. It's going to be all up to you. Let me just tell you how much, what is like, what I missed when I came, how I made here in this country, and then you'll be able to compare what you have. When I came to this country, I did not have any money, I didn't speak English, I had no education, I had 6 years elementary school, I didn't have a job, you name it, I didn't have it. I came here with a friend of mine, we rented a room, one room, that's all we could afford. with one bed, two young boys sleeping in for over a year in one bed because that's all we could have, could afford. In that room we had a lot of cockroaches that slept in our clothes. But we had a table with two chairs, a hot plate and an icebox. But what we did, we had a home. We had a place that you could have come visit us and you could have write to us. That's why when I see a homeless person outside, I don't have too much sympathy for them. I'm not a cold person, because in this country, you can do it if you want to. It's very hard, but you can make it. I needed a job because I was on welfare. You get so used to living on welfare. I finally, after going around for 7 weeks, I finally found somebody that I could communicate with. He offered me a job. The job paid $23.10 a week. I said to my social worker, why would I take this job when I'm getting $37? To me, it was a lot of money then. And she gave me some great advice. You got to start sometimes, the sooner the better. We did not have any McDonald's or Burger King's or any of those places. I took that job. The first day I cleaned the bathroom and I swept the floor. It was up to me to get to where I am today. Today I'm proud and happy to say that I am fairly well off. I live in a very nice apartment. I have three children, they all are college graduates. They came out without having to pay a bill. They're doing quite well. My wife was a stay-at-home mom. That was our decision. You do have the choice here. Think what you can do. By getting your education and knowing what you want to do, not just go and take art or music or something that you might not be able to get a job. Decide what you want to do. You're being taught how to use the tools. I had to learn my tools and learn how to make them and learn how to use them. When you go home, I have a piece of advice for you. Look around you and see what you have. What you have your home, in your home, my parents and those three younger siblings never knew about. Things that you all take, that we all take so much for granted. They never slept in a bed, in a mattress, a regular mattress as we have. They never sat on a couch as we do. My mother never had a washing machine to throw in a bath. And I can go on and on and on that you have. Take advantage of it. Don't become someone that doesn't know what it's doing. You do have the opportunity. You have the freedom that very few people in this world have to choose to do what you want. Don't let it go by. But you have, we all have much more than that. We have something that's called freedom. Freedom is something that's being fought for us right now, been fought for us for years. Millions of men and women gave their lives to have that freedom that we enjoy today. And don't take it for granted that it's coming to you because you're an American. It can come as, you can lose it as fast as you got it. Do what I suggested. And one more thing. When you go home, tell your parents and grandparents, give them a hug and a kiss and tell them how lucky you are having them. I don't have that pleasure. I don't have that. You do, and you feel very good about it. Thank you all for listening. Yeah, sure. Okay. Let's take that off so we can go down there. Let me just add one more thing. This is not me, that man, but that's what I look like, put my face on it. I was so skinny that I didn't, if you don't have any flesh and you lie in one area, your skin comes off. I had no skin in my back. I had to lie on air pillows. When I came out, now you can imagine what it was like. You can't imagine, but you can just think about it. It is a miracle that I'm here today. Bar none. Anyway, thank you. Let's get some questions in. Feel free to ask whatever you want and come up front. We need the first hand. Come on here, come on. I won't be able to hear you there.
You want her to have
that? How long did it take you to learn English?
I'm still learning today. Well, when I came here, I knew every four of the word. I'm sure you probably know it too. But anyway, I worked in a place where they made me speak, no matter even one word, I had to say it in English. And I'm married to someone who was born here, Brooklyn, New York, so I had no choice. But I accept, but I didn't want to know what I'm saying. But you learn all your life. I can't say that I know it, but I can communicate, okay? So that's, thank you.
Yes, sir, Rubin. I'm sure it took you many, many months to regain your physical health.
Yes.
And treatment, and I don't know what all kind of therapy, but about your emotional, mental health, did you have counseling? Did you experience horrible nightmares for years, or were you able to move on quickly and recover emotionally and spiritually as you did physically?
I wished I had met you sooner. Because no, the reason why, seriously, no one asked that question, and I think it's very important. I came out of the camp. If you had known me about 40, 50 years ago, I could not communicate with anybody. I felt so down, inferior. I'm worthless, I'm ugly, I'm dumb, all the things. And I had no counseling. I would even go back a little bit more, even before the war, but it got worse then, because I've been called most of my life, not most of my life, but my first half of my life, every name in the book, and I'm not going to repeat them here. And I was very shy. I still don't know how I ever proposed to my wife. It's true. Because the reason why I met her, how I met her, somebody was a match, her uncle. She came down to visit her uncle. He's also a survivor. And he invited me up there. And you know what happens when a boy and a girl, somebody brings them together? They want to get something out of it. So they got a match, and but I look at people today, those that are in schools, young people in schools, I hear something? Somebody talking? No, I'm sorry. I was very shy, and I did not know how to, I got no counseling. The worst thing you can do, that people can do, is go around and be angry at someone. The counseling, whatever I did, is what you see is what you get. My wife told me, if I was to go around angry, if I was to be angry at Hitler, Hitler would have defeated me, not physically, but psychologically. I'd be a dead person. And he would be happy to know that that's what he did. to be spiteful, I go around and say, no, now I am as good as you are, if not better. And I got out of it. So counseling, I think, in this country, anytime somebody has killed someone, he was mentally unfit or whatever. But he was capable of planning everything and killing that person. I went around and I don't go around and live in the past. I will never forget that past. I live to the future. And right now I feel there's nothing that I can't do. The opposite of what I was, without any counseling. I compare, a baby falls down. And you go over and say, where did you hurt yourself? That baby will keep on crying more and more. But if you go and say, make a joke out of it, that baby will go ahead and do whatever they were doing. Adults are the same way. The more you would feel sorry for me, the more I would amend that sympathy or whatever. I picked myself up and I made a life for myself. My sister and my brother still live in the past today. They never got out of it. They hated the Germans, they hated the Poles. I don't love them, but again, I cannot hate the Germans or the Poles. Because every German, every Pole was anti-Semitic or did those horrible things. So if I'm going to do it, I have to point out that particular person. But don't put everybody as a group. Don't paint everyone with the same brush. I'm fortunate that way. And counseling, maybe some people need it. I didn't need it. I didn't get it. But somehow I got out of it. And if I can do it, everyone can do it. I didn't have any parents to counsel me. I didn't have any family. And I made it. And I go by what, you know, by experience, not by what somebody read in the book, that you do this and do that. Counseling, too much counseling in this country. It's true. Are you a counselor? You're lucky. Even though if you were, I wouldn't have been one of your patients anyway. Anyway, you know, I get serious when there are times when I'm very serious, but also don't live constantly being sad because you're your own worst enemy. And if you ever want to do anything for anybody, I'm talking to the young people here, if you have a friend that has a problem, the best thing, the only thing you can do for a friend is give him an ear. Put a zipper over your mouth and open your ears and listen. It's the greatest gift anyone can give. I got out of that shell because I was so shy and didn't know how to talk to people by a very simple thing. You people here, I'm not talking about you youngsters. You remember the $64,000 question? A 13-year-old boy won $64,000 on that question. I said to a friend of mine, look how smart he is. 13 years knows so much about music. He said to me, Rubin, he's good in music, but you're good in other things. The things you know, he doesn't know. And the next day I was a different person. You saw a different Rubin. We have it gets into our mind thinking we are this or that. But don't go around and make yourself, I'm getting off track a little bit here now. Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else, come on, it's free. Come on here.
So I am a mental health counselor.
You're what?
A mental health counselor, psychologist. And I work at a maximum security prison. So I deal with some guys that have not committed this act, but very horrific acts against other people. What would you say to guys like that?
I don't know. I'm not a psychiatrist. Number one. Number two, I spoke in a prison. I don't know why, but they called me one year to come to a prison. They had 18 students and 9 teachers there, and they wanted me to speak to them. And after I was called, I had a date. They called me up. It's canceled. I said, my wife says, why is it canceled? She says, it's no. She said, where are they going? But anyway, I got there and I did talk to them. And when I finished, one of them came over and put his hand on my shoulder. And he said, I wished I had met you sooner. I didn't ask him why, but I assume he wouldn't have been in the jail. They need, just like every one of us, they need to hear something positive. All they hear is negative things. He's in jail. What am I come out? I'm going back to the same system as I've been there. What is there for me? What's there to live for? So they're thinking of, once they come out, they just go back to where they were. We have to give them some inspiration, some hope. I talked to people I'm staying with. What they need is somebody to tell them that there is a great opportunity for everybody, white, black, Jew, Gentile, whatever. It is up to us. And we have to tell them, but somebody has to tell them, not the one that lives in a big house, a rich man, because a 13-year-old kid, I was a big brother to him for 2 years, told me, a ball player comes into his classroom and says, you should do this, you should go to school, and this and that. Then he goes home to a big house, has lots of money, and I'm going back to the same rat house. Is there any reason for that kid to go to school? There is none. I proudly say that I hope I'm right, that I had something to do, that I know that he did go to, I was with him until he went to college, Loyola University in Baltimore. They need some hope. Give them some hope and assure them that when they go out, there are many places they can go and help him. And I'm not talking about some advisors that you have there that just listen and then after they finish, they let them go. Tell them and mean it, that there's hope. They can learn, get a job at McDonald's and go to school at night. They can do a lot of things. There are offices where they're willing to give them help and they can become somebody. And the reason why I say all of this, because I made it. And if I made it, look what you can do. You get all the help. I didn't get any of it. And that's something for all of you to keep in mind. Thank you. Next. We got an opening. Okay, we have a customer.
You said you have 3 children?
Yes.
How many grandchildren?
7.
7. How do they feel about your stories?
About my story? They know the story. I don't tell them any more than I tell you. Because they look at me as their father or grandfather. They wrote, every one of them wrote many papers in class. If they needed a subject, I am the perfect one. And they know about it, and I happen to be very, very lucky. They're wonderful kids. You know, every parent says, my kid, even those that break windows are looting, they're a wonderful kid. My are wonderful. And the important thing is communication. What I did with my children, we joined a country club. I'm not an athlete, but we joined a club. It was very cheap because I couldn't afford an expensive one. And we had something in common then. We played golf. So instead of talking about school or my job, we talked about golf. And everybody was happy. And we did it together. And nothing like, whenever I see a parent with a child, I look up to them, I admire them. So my children are okay. And grandchildren too.
And great-grandchildren. Your great-grandchildren.
We have a customer.
You got it? Okay.
Okay, so I just want to make sure we got this straight. When you came to this country, you came directly to Baltimore?
Yes.
So, and we've heard you say that you're now well off.
I'm middle class. I won't have to stay in the kitchen, soup kitchen line.
That's good. But can you tell us a little bit about whether it's your career path or your various jobs, the things that you did here in this country to keep you going and to put your kids through college and the sorts of jobs and business enterprises you may have been involved?
Well, I don't know. I was a salesman, as number one. I started out as cleaning the floor and cleaning the bedroom. And it was up to me. I worked there 3 years. Then they wanted me to travel, and I was just married, and we didn't have any family or friends here, my wife. So she wasn't very happy, and I wasn't either, so I said, I won't do it, so they fired me. But someone across the street saw something in me, I don't know what, I didn't ask him, and I really don't care. But he gave me a job, and I was a stock boy there. And then I became a salesman. I liked people, I didn't know how to talk to them, but I liked people, and whatever they took to me, and he gave me an opportunity to go out to try to sell, and he gave me some options. And the options he gave me for 3 months. After 2 weeks, he says, I guess you decided what you want. The option was to be on commission or be on a salary. I wanted a salary. But he gave me 3 months to decide. After 2 weeks, he calls me in the office and he says, Rubin, I guess you decided what you want. You want to be on commission. I said, that's right, because I did so well. And it was up to me. I worked very hard. I knew I had a family to support. I want to make sure that the kids get education. I didn't buy them toys. I gave my children a few years ago some money. And my son said to me, Dad, can I have that yo-yo now? Because I wouldn't buy them toys. I said, you don't need it. But it worked out fine. They're happy. I helped them establish themselves, and we're a great family. Matter of fact, I'm moving right now closer to the family, from Baltimore to Virginia.
Do you have a feeling as to why so many German men became animals during this type of time?
We don't guard ourselves at something, and that is the propaganda minister of Hitler said, give me a microphone and let me talk long enough and people will believe me. We don't watch ourselves, we hear something, read something or see something and say, well, I saw it, or I read it, or I heard it. We don't stop to think, can that be true? A politician will tell you, I'm going to cut your taxes. Oh, yes, I'm for him. He's going to give me a job. I'm for him. How is he going to give you a job? How is he going to cut your taxes before you vote for him? That's why you get the kind of legislators we have in Washington, because they promised and people believed them, and they voted for them. They keep on voting for them every year. We have a two senators in Maryland. They've been there for I don't know how many years, probably for a long time. And ask me, what have they done? I couldn't tell you. So how many people will tell you I voted Democratic or Republican? Why? Because my parents always were that party. We have to stop to think a little bit, put our brain in motion, in gear, before we put our mouth in motion. Put your brain in gear before we put the mouth in motion. Before we do it, think about it. And that's why I saw a show where there were the men that decided the final solution. They were sitting there and talking about that they're doing a favor. Euthanasia is a favor to those that they are applying to. And they applauded at the end. Now, these are not illiterate people. These were doctors, lawyers, and well-educated. They can be converted. How can a man go out and killing somebody and having the same kind of people home, same family? Must be something in their brains, I don't know what. Again, I have never looked. You have to ask Dr. Carson. He'll tell you more about it. Anyway, next, we got one more opening. Oh, it's quiet. All right, we have.
I'm curious to your opinion between the relationship of Israel and the United States as today.
What's that?
The relationship with the United States and Israel today. What's your opinion?
Very sad, in my opinion. Are you Jewish?
No, sir.
Okay. Very sad. Not only Israel is the only democratic country in that area. There's a democracy there, the same as it is here. We don't have any true friends. They voted for with America all their lives. Israel is the only country that can never be on the Security Council. Out of 180 some countries, Israel is the only one that can do it. The Jewish people need a home, just like everybody else. If we would have had a home, I might not have been a Holocaust survivor. We would have had a place to go. And they are surrounded, 200 million, now it's more, you have the others, surrounded by 5.5 million Israelis are surrounded by hundreds of million Arabs. Now, I'm not saying that all Arabs are terrorists, they're not. And yet, this president of the United States went and sold Israel, just practically sold him, allowing Iran to have an atomic weapon. It only they can defend themselves, but all it takes for Israel is one, and again, we have a Holocaust. And I don't want to live to see it. No matter what, Israel has been very, very friendly towards the United States and vice versa until this one came along. And he did not like us from the beginning. Not only that he's a bad president, you know, doesn't know what the heck he's doing, this is my opinion, but that he's selling other people down the tube. So I am very disappointed in him. I was disappointed even before that, but now more so. Now he made me do it. I didn't want to do it. Anyway, the other thing also, there's a time to be sad, a time to be funny, if you can. I will get very serious, and I can change like a split, you know, split minute, seconds. And there's also, we have to laugh sometimes also we cannot be serious all the time. So forgive me if you think that I'm very serious about life and what's going on in this country and the world. I see Syrians today and I feel sorry for them because I can relate to it. I've been there, I've done that. When you're out there, you don't have a home. You don't know whether you're ever going to go back to home and you have little kids with you and the world still doesn't care. In this country, more people know every score of the baseball and football than they know where Annapolis is. People don't care about what is. I'm not concerned for myself. I'm concerned for them, for all of you. Because I am my age and I'm 90 years young. You know, how much more have I got? Another 20 years. I have no plans to go. Okay, anyway, thank you all so very much. You'll be great. And good luck to all of you. Is it for me or for my wife?
It's for you. No, it's for you.
Okay.
You can share.
I don't want you to know because you might want to.
You want to open it?
If you want me to, sure.
Garrett County maple syrup.
who's got the pancakes? I provide the syrup.
And this Thank is you. Something for you and your wife to share. Nice soft blanket from Garrett.
Now, I don't do any cooking. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Very much. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you'll join us again for another Joan Crawford.
I'm going to nominate you to run for president.
What?
That's what we need. We need some.